snowstorm we had the other week. Spring is finally springing. It's getting warmer and nicer outside. And Brother Eli, would you collect some squawk? God is so concerned about souls, it's not even funny. If we look at the Bible and look at the words of Jesus Christ, you know, he talked about hell more than he did heaven. When we talk about, look at the Bible and break it down, you know that there are probably more passages concerning with eternity than there is the gifts of the Spirit or what God has given to us. There's more verses concerned about the salvation of individuals than there are the blessing that God has given to us. And there are a lot of verses on blessings. But what was the primary motive that Jesus came to earth? Yes, he came to die on the cross. But what was the purpose behind it?
To save sinners.
To save sinners. To seek and to save that which is lost. When we look throughout the Word of God, the Bible nowhere states that Jesus died on the cross to create the church. When we look at the Word of God, there's nowhere that states that Jesus hung on the cross that we might get gifts and become pastors or preachers. Those are add-ons. When we look at the Word of God, everything leading up to the crucifixion and death of Christ is based upon the fact of simply that God so loved the world. He didn't say the church, or just church, he said the world, everybody in it. Why? Because he was concerned with souls. If we could hear the heartbeat of God, guess what it would be? The lost, the lost, the lost. The heart of God is to reach every individual out there and to take as many with him as possible. And if that is the heartbeat of God, how much more should it be our heart? So many times we pray, God, give me the mind of Christ and give me the heart of God. David prayed, create in me a clean heart of God. God, do that for me. All the while, God wants to do that, but he wants to get us to have a heart after his own heart. And that would be to reach the lost before it's too late. When we look at the words of Christ, he said that there is a harvest ready to be gathered. And that everybody's knocking on the door to go gather. No, he says, the laborers are few. He said, pray ye that the Lord of the harvest would send forth laborers. Well, guess who God calls? He's called you, he's called me. And we don't need to hear an audible voice to know that. He said, I have chosen you, and I have called you. He said, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel. He said, take the gospel to all parts of the world, Judea, Samaria, and all the uttermost parts. God is expecting us to take the gospel message to the lost. But before we can really be effective, we need to get a vision for souls. Why do we need to get a vision for souls? Because A, that's the heartbeat of God, and B, we'll accomplish a whole lot more in prayer. Because we can pray cold prayers for the lost. We really can. God save so-and-so. God save so-and-so. And maybe we'll shed a tear or two. But to really pray for the lost, to really get down to the nitty-gritty, because guess what? Our emotions are what stirs the hand of God. And if he already wants to save the lost, how much more does he want to answer those prayers? How much more does he want to work in their own lives? But it comes down to you, and it comes down to me. And after we get evangelistic eyesight, after we get a burden for the lost, after we realize and find ourselves in the boat of those in the book of Jude, who with fear plucked down the fire. No, they didn't say cold prayers, but they went out seeking whom they might save from the flames of hell. It was John praying high who prayed, God, give me one soul today. God, give me one soul today. And then after he got one soul, he started praying, God, give me two souls today. God, give me two souls today. And it went on and on and on. We need to get a vision for the lost. Because if we don't, who will? I believe it was Isaiah, whom God asked, Whom shall I send? And who will go before us? You know, that can become our prayer as well. God, why don't you send so-and-so to go touch this individual? God, why don't you send so-and-so to reach this individual? But what happens when God says, I want you to go? You know, when we look at Isaiah, he didn't wait for God to stay in there and pause and, well, I'm waiting for an answer. What are you going to do with Isaiah? But rather we see, he said, here am I, send me. No, God's not looking for the most talented. He's not looking for the most fluent with words. If he was, I wouldn't be standing up here. He's not looking for the best person to talk to people. He's not looking for the person who has everything in order in their minds. Okay, this is what I do. This is what I do here. God doesn't call the qualified. He qualifies the call. And he's called us to go and reach the lost. All he's looking for is a willing vessel. And he's waiting for us to say, Lord, here am I. Send me. Once we get a vision for the lost, then we need to act on it. I was reading after Finney here. I've been reading his book, The Power of God. And he was talking in there how a lot of people pray, but they need to put actions behind their prayers. He said, if you're going to go into missions work or God gives you a vision to do something, pray for it, but then you need to put your resources to work. You know, go act and put action behind your faith. We need to do the same thing when it comes to reaching the lost. We don't need to just pray for them. But we need to put our resources into it. We need to go forward and let God supply the rest. He said, open your mouth and I will fill it. No, we don't always have the answers. And it is all right to say, if somebody asks you a hard question, you don't know, I don't know. Saying I don't know is a whole lot better than giving them the wrong answer and they find out at some point that that's a wrong answer and so-and-so lied to me. I don't want to go to that church. But God is looking for people who are willing. And if we are willing and say, God, here I am, send me, and we make an effort, God will bless us and he will help us. But we need to put action behind our prayers. It's not a matter of just praying for our community, but we need to go out and tell them about Christ. We talked about this in the past as well. How many people from different churches in the area have come knocking on your doors? But how many times have the Jehovah's Witnesses been there knocking on your door? I can think of two times in the last year that I've had the Jehovah's Witnesses knocking on my door. But there are no other churches in the area that have knocked on my door and said, hey, why don't you come to church? Now, there are people out there that are sometimes just waiting for you to say, why don't you come to church with us on Sunday? Or why don't you come join us at church on Sunday? They're just waiting for an invitation. But how will they ever go to church if no one invites them? We need to put the effort behind it. We need to take an effect and prepare ourselves. What happens when you're planning on doing something? You don't just jump into a task blindly, but rather you study down a little bit. I know if I'm going to work on my vehicle, I'm not near as familiar as Brother Terry over here. I'm way down at the bottom of the scale, but I can look into simple stuff. You know, there's people that will come into Walmart and say that they don't want to change their own wipers because they're not mechanically inclined. I at least try to change my wipers. I can do that much. But it took effort. At some point in my life, Dad showed me, you have to press this little clip here, turn it this way, and slide it. But there was a learning part that I had to endorse at some point in my life. There was practice. There was something I had to put into it. You're not going to go knocking on somebody's door to tell them about Christ without having something invested in you, without having some resources at your disposal, without having some head knowledge. And the majority of the people in here have been in church for a very long time. So if we sat down and somebody asked us how to get saved, even if we don't know the verses, we should be able to tell them, you know. Adam sinned in the garden. Because of Adam, we have all sinned. We are born into it. But Jesus died on the cross that we don't have to go to hell. If you confess your sins and accept Jesus as your personal Savior and mean it, and change from your wicked ways, you'll be saved. We at least know that part. We got the basics down. But it still takes effort. Because like everything else, if you're going to do something, you don't get just the basics and say, oh, I'm good. With time, you get practice, and the more you do it, the better you get. Evangelism is no different. And there will be times that you forget scripture verses. We all do. Or we'll forget exactly where they're located. Or if we try to quote it, we might mess it up. And you can't do worse than I did, because trust me, there have been several Sunday schools where I've accidentally misquoted the rapture verse and said, when this mortal puts on immorality. If that doesn't top the cake, I don't know what does. But the thing is, we need to tell us about Christ before it's too late. And if we're going to be effective, the more that we do it, the better we're going to get. The more we use the verses, the more we're going to better we're going to remember. And there are several different methods when it comes to evangelism and reaching the lost. There are several successful or good ways to reach the lost, and there are several bad methods to reach the lost. The one that comes to my mind right off the top of my head is, you're going to hell! You're drinking. You're going to go to hell! You're going out partying this week. You're going to go to hell! Guess how effective that is? It's not very effective at all. If anything, it's a turnoff. And there are churches, and don't think that just happens out in the community. It happens in churches too. There have been times when people from maybe a southern church or a holiness church, somebody comes in from the outside that doesn't quite look like they should according to our standards, or they might not be wearing the appropriate attire. And instead of following what God has for the message of the service, somebody gets up and lands blasts that person for whether the woman's wearing pants, jewelry, guy's wearing shorts. And that becomes the topic and focus of the service. Well, guess what that does to the individual? It's a huge turnoff. Especially if they've never been in church before. They don't know why women wear skirts, or they don't know why women don't wear jewelry, or they don't know why guys don't wear shorts, or we don't come in with a tank top or anything like that. They don't know better. I seen something floating around Facebook. It was dealing with a parent talking to their child, and it was referring to them in their senior years. I can't remember if it was referring to them having to be taken care of or what. Oh, I remember what it was. An elderly person referring to their son or granddaughter or grandson, not to make fun of them on how, because they don't know how to use a computer a lot. Don't make fun of them for that, because there was a one point in that child's life where they had to be taught how to use a spoon. We didn't get to where we are in life just like that. We had to be taught how to use a spoon, how to use a fork. Some people might smile, but face it, we go to a Chinese restaurant, we had to learn how to use the chopsticks. And if we didn't learn how to use them, then you just end up sticking your General Tso's and all those pieces of chicken and start eating them like a spear. Everything in life is a learning process. And when it comes to evangelism is no different. But there is wisdom to be used as well. And we can decipher some things right off the bat. Like I said, the you're going to hell method definitely doesn't work. If somebody's doing something that they shouldn't be doing, and they've never been to church before, you start land blasting them. They're never going to welcome to church. But, and guess what? If they are living that kind of lifestyle, it's not our job to clean up the fish before they're caught. It's our job to get them to Jesus Christ and let Him clean them up. But we need to have a personal method when it comes to evangelism. And not everybody's method will be the same. And yes, I'm using method, but we'll look at it in more detail. But it's just a way to approach individuals. I mean, we all have methods, we all have routines. And not everyone's going to be the same. Ray Comfort, that we listened to the last 2 weeks, he has his own method. will have Bibles. The book that I've been quoting from, Nate Krupp's, You Can Be a Soul Winner, he has his own method. Sister Goodwin from the Bible school, they're down helping in Texas at a church. She has her own method to evangelism. Sister Beth has her own method to evangelism. Maybe it's taking a bit of this person, taking that person, tweaking it a little bit, adding it, combining it. But the way that you approach an individual doesn't have to be exactly the same as somebody else's. That can get you into trouble as well. Hopefully it doesn't. But if you think about a routine and somebody trying to convert you to their religion, guess, does anybody come to mind? They're almost the only ones out there knocking on doors. The Jehovah's Witnesses. They come, what happens? If you actually listen to them, they have their routine. They know what to say next. But if you get them off of that routine, what happens? They get lost. Why? They know their routine, but they don't know what they believe and why they believe. Hopefully we have an advantage. We know what we believe, and we know why we believe. And if we have to, we can actually confront somebody if they bring up, well, what about this? Well, let's look at this. But it's also remember, it's okay to say, well, I don't know. But we will have our own method, we'll have our own routine, we'll have a starting point, we'll have a destination point, we'll know where we want to go. And that's something that we'll want to start thinking about when we gather together our own personal method for evangelism. Now, what do you say upon approaching the individual? I mean, it's almost like a little mini sermon or a little mini lesson. You know, you got to have a starting point. What do you want to open up and say? You knock on that door and they open it up, are you just going to say, what do you want? You got to have a starting point. Where do you want to start? What's your opening line? Then you want to know, where do you want to go in the Bible to show them that they need Christ? So you have your opening line, but what's your plan for it? Are you just going to stumble through it? Or are you actually going to have something planned? Because think about it, you might only have one shot to reach this individual. One shot. What do you want to tell them? What do you want to open with? What do you want to say? How do you want to close it? What do you want the last words to say? Do you want to just say, well, you need Christ? Do you want me to lead you to Christ? Do you want me to show you scripture verses? Do you want me to pray with you? Are you planning on just asking, hey, well, why don't we pray about this? Now, what are your focal points? What are you aiming towards? What's your goal? Where are we planning on going with this? When we lead, do we want to lead with a prayer? Do we want to lead with some material, Christian literature? Do we want to lead with a tract? Do we want to lead with a pamphlet of the church so they know where we attend if they change their mind or if they have accepted Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, that they have a place to go? And also, when we conclude, what if they say no? What are we going to do then? What if they do get saved? What are we going to do then? Are we going to leave them there? Are we going to give them scripture verses to read? Are we going to point them in the Bible? When it comes to evangelism, what do we have in mind? You know, we have to have a plan. That's why I call it a method. You know, what are the steps? Where are we planning on going? Will it always flow smoothly? Absolutely not. Why will it not always flow smoothly? Because if you've ever dealt with people or dealing with people, hardly ever anything goes smoothly or goes as it should. You know, something quite happens that you didn't plan on, or they say something, or they don't seem quite right in the head, or, you know, there's always something. But we have a good foundational starting. Now, say, Lord, here am I, send me. But like I said, we've been in church long enough. But now it's a matter of getting a game plan. No, if we are going to honestly win souls for Christ, we need to have a plan. Every business that was started did not happen by accident. Long, long time ago, there was a guy who sold, I think it was body filler or body putty. Well, over time, his style became obsolete. Something better came along or whatever. But his kid, he looked over one day and his kids were playing with it on the floor. He then changed the marketing on it from whatever it was before, which I didn't look at it. Forgive me, this is on a whim. Pull it out from the recesses of my mind, as dangerous as that is. But that product that became obsolete for him is what we call Play-Doh today. And how many kids play with Play-Doh? You know, that wasn't something accidental, it didn't just morph. But he had an idea, he had a goal. Let's run with it. No, nothing happens by accident. If we are going to be effective in evangelism, it's going to first start with us. When we are intentional with getting a vision for our souls, when we are intentional of getting a vision for the lost and a vision of hell, we'll become effective evangelism when we begin getting intentional in prayer. God, don't just change my heart, but God, give me the words you have me say. Teach me. Because guess what? We have the greatest teacher at our disposal, the Holy Ghost. I couldn't tell you what to say in every situation, but he can. I can't lead you in how to act in every situation, but he can. If we are going to be effective in evangelism, it begins with us being intentional on how we're going to go about it. And even though our game plan or our method might not go smoothly every time, we have something that we are starting with. We have a starting point. We know what our goals are. We know where we want to go. Now we looked at the you're going to hell approach a little bit. Not only is it a turnoff and ineffective, but it gives us a bad name. It really does. We want to lead them to Christ. We don't want to turn them away from Christ. When we look at the scriptures, in the book of Romans, that's the book that deals with salvation, talks about the salvation experience, you know, those things I wish I did not do, but I do. You know, the struggle between the carnal man and the spiritual man, the growing process. In the beginning of the book, it states that every mouth should be stopped. What does that mean? It means when it comes to their sin that every mouth should be stopped. But there's a better way of doing it than, Brother Eli, I saw you drinking that beer, you're going to hell. There's a better way of approaching it. How about, Brother Eli, do you know what God thinks I'm drinking? Would you like to look at some verses on why God? It's not something that I'm saying, but it's something that God says. No, it doesn't. If we want to use a real life example, we can use homosexuality. No, just because the world says it's okay, the church world slowly starting to say that it's okay. Big name churches are starting to say that it's okay. But when we look at the Word of God, it is still an abomination in His sight. No, that does not change. It's not me saying that matter that it's not right, but it's matter. This is what God thinks, and He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Do you think that He still disapproves of it? The answer would be yes. God's Word never changes. You know, one of the biggest reasons why I believe that some of the holiness churches down south have trouble with dress, because they preach dress and the way that they should appear so hard, but they don't use scripture verses behind it, and nobody knows why. We need to show people that this isn't a religion. This isn't a quote-unquote cult. We didn't drink the Kool-Aid. The Kool-Aid's all right. It's good to drink. But rather, this is what God says. It's not what I say. This is God's Word. And we need to be ready to show them from God's Word how to accept Jesus Christ as a personal Savior. That every